Parents even say that my first word was no. Like a little kid saying no. And it's this personality flaw that like is stubborn and strong-willed and really wants to do my thing my own way, how I want to do it. And it's been really good for me in some ways, but it's also been really bad. Where it's been really good was when I was in middle school and high school, peer pressure was not really an issue for me. Not only the fact that I had really, really good Christian friends that surrounded me, but I saw the way some of my friends were living that were not Christians, and they were doing some things, and I just looked at them and they would say, "Hey, you want to do this?" No, I see what it's doing in your life. I have no desire for that. You go for it. That's your thing. So peer pressure wasn't an issue. But on the flip side, if a teacher in particular, and Dad, I'm so sorry. My dad's a teacher, and so this is much to his chagrin. When there was a teacher that would tell me to do an assignment that was ridiculous and I thought pointless, I would not want to do it at all. I would fight my way through it and sometimes do the very, very bare minimum, or even skip, or even do the Spark Notes ability, so write a paper on a book based totally on Spark Notes instead of actually reading the book. And so I hated assignments. There were some assignments in high school that I really didn't want to do. So that got me into some trouble at home and at school. But what I've begun to realize is part of that personality, there's some things that God has done that's been really good through it, but there's been some things that have not been so good. And that it's been this struggle and this hard thing for me to have to learn to truly surrender my will to God when I really don't want to. Because the whole point of the Christian life is not to just live a life of like this obligatory obedience, oh God, you're telling me to do this, so yeah, I guess I'm going to do it. Or even being able to have the freedom to do whatever I want. The point is to willingly submit myself to God and say, God, you are the king of the world. I am submitting myself to you. We forget sometimes Jesus, he is our Savior. He forgives us our sins and died on the cross to save us from our sins. But he also wants to be Lord of our lives, to be the one that we look to and say, God, what is it you want me to do? How do you want me to live? And that's something that is extremely hard for us because our nature is to say no. I might have a more strong nature than many of you in the room, but I think that is a generally human thing to do, to say, no, I'm going to do what I want to do. I'm going to do my way. I'm going to look out for number one, work out for myself. And so today we're going to look at how even Jesus, the Son of God, submitted himself to the Father. And we are going to see how Jesus created this standard for us in terms of having an attitude towards our relationship with God. So this morning we're going to look at four attitudes that we are to have in our relationship with God and the way that we submit and surrender to him. So I'm going to go ahead and invite you to turn to Mark chapter 14. If you have a Bible with you, we're going to be in verses 32 through 42. If you do not have a Bible, we invite you. There are these brown hardcover backs right in the seat in front of you. And so you can pull that out and it's going to be on page 1020. So that you can follow along with us. And part of the reason we have it, we want you to look and hear, and we want you to see it up on the screen, is so that you can see that, we're not making this stuff up, that it's like, it's actually here, and you can see that we're not manipulating the words to say what we want them to say, but this is what they are. This is what the Word of God has to say to us. So while you're turning there, I'm going to set up the story for us a little bit. Because Mark is very purposeful in how he organizes his gospel. What he does is he's pointing Jesus now into the direction where he's focused now on the cross. And so right before the story we're going to look at, the Garden of Gethsemane, right before this is what we call the Last Supper. If you've seen that Leonardo da Vinci painting, this is what we're talking about, the Last Supper. And at the Last Supper, Jesus basically tells his disciples, you're all going to abandon me. Peter, being the foot and mouth guy of the group, stands up and he says, Lord, even if all of these deny you, I will never deny you. And Jesus looks at him and says, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. Ouch. And that happens at the Last Supper, right before this story. And then after this story, it happens. All the other disciples abandon Jesus. I mean, they go running. They split as soon as Jesus is arrested. They're out of there. And Peter too. And Peter does do what Jesus said he was going to do, and before the rooster crows, he denies Jesus three times. And Mark is doing this on purpose to show that Jesus truly is alone. He is by himself in this next stage of his life of being the Messiah, that now he is going forward alone. He doesn't have the disciples with him. And so what we see at this point is a turning point. Jesus now knows the time has come for him to be prepared to go to the cross. And so then he starts to feel the emotional weight of what's about to happen. And that's what we're going to look at in the Garden of Gethsemane. So we're going to go ahead and read verses 32 through 34. Again, it's in your Bibles, page 1020, and it'll also be up on the screen. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." And so what Jesus does is they go to, right after this Last Supper, they go up to a common place that Jesus went many times to pray and be alone with God. And it's called the Garden of Gethsemane. And the word Gethsemane actually literally means oil press. And they actually called the whole area that the garden was placed in, it was called the Mount of Olives. And where the mount was is it overlooked the entire city of Jerusalem. Jesus from there could see the temple. He could see the entire city. And at that point, he starts to feel the emotional weight of what is going to be happening. And so he takes his disciples with him. And first what he does, he takes eight of them. And there's 11 because one of them, Judas, has left to go betray Jesus. He's setting up his betrayal. So he only has 11 of his 12 with him. And he sets aside eight. So this includes guys like Thomas and Andrew, Bartholomew, Philip, guys like that. He sets them aside. And then he takes Peter, James, and John, and he takes them a little bit farther to the place where they could actually see him praying. And he tells all of his disciples to sit here while I pray. But it's interesting that he decides to bring Peter, James, and John along. We have to ask the question, why those three? Why Peter, James, and John? First of all, we have Peter, who immediately had just said, even if all these others deny you, I won't. So he's already elevated himself to a standard of like, yeah, I'm going to be pretty obedient. I'm going to be following you even to the death. I'm with you, Jesus. And then James and John, in another story in the Gospels, they have their mom represent for them. So you know that, you know, this is a really strong way to do it, to have your mom go for you. And so they have their mom go up, and their mom asks, Can my sons be at your right hand and at your left hand in my kingdom? Basically, can they take the top two positions in your future kingdom? Can you put them there? And Jesus, instead of answering that, he looks at them and looks at James and John and says, "Can you drink the cup that I am going to drink?" And we'll talk about what he means by saying that in a minute. But they both say yes. So these two have also elevated themselves. And so by doing that, by elevating themselves, they are now more susceptible to the temptation to desert Jesus, is really what's going on here. So Jesus is telling them, and look at what he tells them. And they should have noticed this too. They should have noticed that he is deeply distressed and troubled, that the demeanor of Jesus completely changes at this point, that emotionally something is going on. They should be noticing, you know, Jesus is acting a little bit strange. He's acting different than he usually does. He's feeling the sorrow and feeling it. And we have to ask the question, what is it that Jesus is so stressed about? What he's stressed about is the impending sacrifice that he is going to have to be on behalf of all mankind. And it's not just the physical pain of crucifixion that's going to be excruciating. And we have to understand, too, that word excruciating legitimately comes from where crucifixion is all about, because they had to make up a word, excruciating, to explain how painful crucifixion was. So it's excruciating. That's how painful it was. It's not just the physical part of it. It's the emotional part, because what's going to happen is 2 Corinthians 5:21 says to us that he became sin who knew no sin so that we might become the righteousness of God. What's going to happen, this is symbolize and foreshadow in the Old Testament when they would pray over the sacrificial lamb and pray the sins of the people over the lamb. And so Jesus is the sacrificial lamb. He was the one that was foreshadowed. And he is going to take on all of our sin. I'm talking past, present, future, all of it. Every single one of us in our room, every single person that has ever existed in this entire world, Jesus took their sin onto himself. I think that would be pretty heavy weight to bear. Not only that, because he becomes sin, it then does this crazy thing where it separates him and God. Jesus said numerous times throughout the Gospels that he and the Father are one, that they are united, that they are one. And by becoming sin, he then it separates him, because God is holy and God is perfect. He can't have sin on him. It's not who he is. And so Jesus becomes separate. And so then it's that emotional weight of knowing he's going to be separated from his Father. He's going to feel the full weight of what it's like to be us, and even more so because he's taking on sin onto his life. And so that's what Jesus is so stressed about. But you can tell. You can tell that the disciples throughout this story, that they don't understand what it is that Jesus is so stressed about. And Luke tells us in another gospel that Jesus was so emotionally stressed that he went through this medical thing. And if you're in the medical field, and I butcher this term, I apologize. I am not in the medical field, so not my forte. The term is hematidrosis. Basically, it's to the point where the blood vessels surrounding your sweat glands, when you're so stressed, like burst enough to the point that you start to bleed through, you like bleed and sweat at the same time. So it's this really crazy thing that happens, and it only happens in severe stress and trauma. So this is the level at which Jesus is feeling this stress. And so we have to ask the question of what is it that Jesus is doing? What's his attitude here of how he is acting? And notice what he does. First thing that he does when he comes, when he's feeling this emotional weight, is he goes straight to prayer. And so that's our attitude, number one, is that prayer is a lifestyle and not a last resort. It's something that we do as a part of our life, that is something that is always that we're doing. Not something that we turn to when push comes to shove, when it's at the very end. We do this all the time. When we're sad, we pray. When we're happy, we pray. When we're blessed, we pray. When we're frustrated, we pray. When it's just a normal run of the day, nothing really happening, normal kind of day, we pray. It's a lifestyle. It's a habit. Paul even says in 1 Thessalonians 5 that we are to pray without ceasing. And this is not what I mean. Because some people might hear this. They might think of like praying like this, where you fold your hands, close your eyes, and like we teach our kids to do, which there's good time for this. But to pray without ceasing and do this and basically do this like everywhere you go, you're going to walk into things and people are just going to laugh at you. Okay, you're going to look ridiculous. What this really is more about is the attitude, the conversation. I always think about prayer like a conversation, this really reverent conversation between me and God, where I'm able to really like pour out my heart. You know, one of the things that I have had to learn in my Christian life is that God is ready and willing to hear our honesty. You see that. I mean, Jesus exemplifies this here in this story. Jesus is ready for us to say, this is what I'm feeling, and I'm not too happy about it. God, I don't like what's going on here. God is not afraid of it. And so prayer is one of those opportunities for us to come before God and just say, God, I'm struggling. I need your help. God, would you be with me? Would you change my heart? Would you change my attitude? Because God, I want to do this different. I want to understand this. I want to live in a different way. This is what we are able to do in our relationship with God, is to come to him with full and unbridled honesty. But again, it's a lifestyle. It's not something that we do as a last resort where it's like, okay, now that things are finally going awful, now I'll finally pray. You pray all the time. And we don't think of prayer like a wish list, like we're talking to a genie, you know, where God, hey, here's my wish list. It's saying to God, God, as we'll see in a minute, your will be done, not mine. God, I'm giving myself to you. God, would you work on my life? Would you change my heart? So that's our first attitude. Let's look at verses 35 through 36. Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. So after Jesus has set aside the Peter, James, and John, he goes out a little farther and it says he falls to the ground. And what that is portraying is Jesus like falling flat on his face onto the ground, prostrate before God. And this is a symbol of like full submission and surrender to God, putting himself at God's mercy before him. And so usually in that day, they would stand and pray, you know, stand up and look confident and speak your prayers loudly and boldly, and Jesus falls flat on his face. So again, disciples should be noticing, Jesus is doing something really weird. Not quite sure about that. What is up with him? And notice the nature of what he is praying. His prayer, Mark describes it for us, that if possible, the hour might pass from him. Jesus is basically asking with this prayer, God, I know what's about to happen. Father, I know what's going to happen. You're going to put me on that cross. I'm going to feel that weight of sin. I'm going to feel that separation, and I don't want that. Take this, and he says, remove this cup from me. Take it away from me. I don't want it. Remove it from your plan. So Jesus, this is where we see like the real, raw humanity of who Jesus is and being both human and divine, the nature of Jesus being both human and divine. We see a really strong human moment, and it's really relatable for us, right? How many times do we pray where we go, God, I really don't want you to do that. I see what you're doing. I really don't want it. Nope, 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 pass. Find somebody else. Or something happens and we say to God, God, I did not like that. And man, have I walked in that many times in my life where I went, God, you just did something I really didn't like. I'm not happy with you right now. You took this thing away from me. It's like you're a human and I'm a cat and you're dangling a ball of yarn and pulling it up in front of me all the time. Well, I want it. No. God does this. But look at how Jesus is acting. He's acting in this way where it's very relatable to us. And then look at what else he does. He says to him, Abba, Father. That term Abba in that language is like the equivalent of our term like daddy. It's like really informal term. So like one of my things I cannot wait for as a dad. If you're new with us this morning, I have a 9.5-month-old baby girl. I cannot wait for the moment when I come home from work and she's waiting for me. And then I hear the pitter-patter of her feet running to the door and I hear her screaming, Daddy! Ooh, first time that happens, I'm probably going to just fall over. I'm going to just melt. I can't wait for that. But it's that kind of tone. And usually in that culture, they would say, Abba, whoa, too personal. Way too close. You got to talk to God super reverently. You got to use these official terms that, you know, are like approved and show him reverence. And yes, we still need to show God some reverence and be serious about our relationship with God, but we can also come to him in a way that's saying, Abba, Father. Abba. And again, that take this cup from me. We talked about it earlier. What he's talking about is he's taking this cup. In the Old Testament is this visual of the outpouring of God's wrath onto mankind. It's about suffering. So when you look at that James and John passage, Jesus is basically telling them, are you willing to suffer what I'm going to suffer? And here's what Jesus fully suffered on the cross. We have to understand this. Because God hates sin. Hear that very clearly. It's not a super popular idea because we want to hear God, think about God as this fluffy teddy bear that just wants to give you a big hug, which he is a God of love and he wants to hug, he wants to embrace you, he wants to know you, but he has to do something about sin. We often think of the word wrath, the wrath of God, as like this random, irrational, and volatile anger where you're just scared. So like if my Oregon Ducks lost last night, there would have been some very, very silent and angry wrath because Avery was asleep and I didn't want to wake her up. But there would have been some very silent, angry wrath because, no, my Ducks lost. Or if they messed up and did something to screw it up, then I would have lost it. Not that kind of wrath. God's wrath is more about God's justice. And we all have this in our human sense that we think, you know what? God, I really don't like that this evil thing happened in the world. Neither does God. And if you ever read the book of Revelation, God finally says, enough is enough. I'm going to take care of this. And he's going to carry out his justice. And so we think of the cross. The cross is really about God's justice being displayed, that he hated sin so much to the point that he was willing to come into human flesh, become one of us, and then take on sin from all of us, go onto the cross and die on our behalf. That's the level that God hates sin, is that he took it on himself. Not just that God looked above us and said, man, you screw ups, figure it out. And judging us from up there, but he said, no, I'm going to come down here and I'm going to die for you so that you can come and know me. That's the level that God hates sin, that he wants to be in the relationship, that he put himself there. And so this is the second attitude, is to submit yourself wholly to God's will. The nature of what Jesus is doing here is he is saying, yet not my will, but what your will be done, but what you will. God, your will in my life. And this is a hard kind of attitude and prayer for all of us. Because like I said earlier, we want to be in control. We want to have these things. We want to have our certain ways of living. But the main attitude of our prayers and of our relationship with God is to constantly be saying, not my will, God, yours. Not mine, yours be done. And that's our second attitude. And it's a hard one, I'm telling you. And so we have to ask this question at this point. How are you daily submitting to Jesus, your will to God? How are you daily doing that? It's important that you do this every single day, because we're humans and we're extremely forgetful. Okay, we're almost like goldfish, where our memory spans are like that. We need to be refreshed every single day and submit ourselves every single morning to relearn what this means. And so think about this in your life. How are you daily submitting? It's not just about coming here on Sunday mornings and being a part of church, which we're glad you're here, but Christians are on all the time. We are on call 24/7, 365, all the time. We are always on duty, ready to submit, ready to surrender. And that is difficult for us as human beings, because it's not how we are. And we can't live in a manner in which we dictate the terms of our surrender to God. God, I'll do this thing, but I won't do this. No, it's a matter of you surrender everything, every little piece, and you say to him, God, your will be done, not mine. Because Jesus even says at one point, if you want to be my disciple, to take up your cross, deny yourself, and follow me. That's not a really popular phrase, but this is the standard. And Jesus says, if you can't do that, you cannot be my disciple. It's that clear. And so we talked about it earlier, but that sometimes we have this idea that we only believe in Jesus and then that covers it. No, it's a both and. You believe in Jesus and surrender your will to him to the point that your life is now his. You basically say, I'm following what you want me to do. It's not just about agreeing with some principles and ideas in your head and believing it. Belief is about, the actual word in the Greek means to pledge to be faithful. That I am going to make myself faithful to God. So when I say I believe in God, that means I am devoting my life to be faithful to him and submit myself to him. Belief isn't just an intellectual thing, it's an action thing too, where we act out in our relationship with God and show him that we believe. Okay, we're going to look at verses 37 to 38. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. So Jesus comes back from praying and he finds the disciples sleeping. And notice who he picks out first. Peter. Why? Remember, Peter. I mean, we're talking 45 minutes to an hour before this, that he goes, Jesus, even if all these other ones abandon you, I will not. And so Jesus is calling him out. He's like, couldn't even you keep watch for an hour? Aren't you supposed to be the superstar? Aren't you supposed to be the one that won't abandon? And look at you right now, you're sleeping. And Jesus isn't necessarily condemning sleep in general, because, you know, we're humans and we have a body and we need to sleep. It's very important. But he's getting at them that they're not aware of what's going on. They're not paying attention. The whole thing of what they're supposed to be watching for is to be spiritually awake and vigilant for what's going on around them. To be aware, to be paying attention. And notice that what it is, like Jesus even says that you are supposed, that they're supposed to be watching for and pray. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. And the temptation for them was to give over themselves to other things that would cause them to abandon Jesus. So a lot of times why we might fall into temptation, why we might sin, is because of the fact that we care more about what other people think, or we desire something else more than we do God. And so our whole attitude as Christians is to constantly be on the lookout. That's our attitude number three, is to lean on the Holy Spirit to defeat temptation. Because here's what happens. Temptation comes and strikes whenever. But it does strike, especially at times when we are weak, when we might be bored, we might be hungry, we might be angry, tired, sick. Those kind of situations, that's where you're at your weakest. Or a circumstance comes in your life and you weren't prepared for it. It's coming. You're gonna feel the weakness. And the Bible even says about Satan that he is a roaring and prowling lion looking for things to devour. So think of sin like this little thing that is waiting to simply pounce and devour you. It's not like a little white lie, a little fib, this tiny little thing. It's no big deal. No, it's trying to kill you. It's trying to eat you. And if you've ever watched Discovery Channel and seen a lion eat something, devour it, I don't want any part of that. Okay, no thanks. Pass. But also, sin is talked about in the book of Proverbs as an adulteress who is trying to get men to come to her to be with her. And the book of Proverbs says her steps lead to death. So don't think about sin like, oh darn, I messed up. It's a little mistake. Yes, you did, and that's one way to look at it. But it's also something that is trying to destroy you and trying to kill you. It really is. And we have to understand that we can't do this on our own. Look at what it says. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Jesus is telling him, look, you want to do it. And I would say all of us in this room who are followers of Christ, we want to step away from sin. We don't want to do that stuff anymore. We know what it does to our hearts. We know what it does to our lives. We don't want that. But then sometimes the flesh, it starts to look good. You know, think about it like a donut. I love donuts. And it's laced with poison. Okay? I know, that sounds terrifying. And you want that donut, but you know it's laced with poison. Or you might not even know. But what sin is trying to do, it might look really good on the outside, but by consuming it, it will kill you. So even if in the moment it's super delicious, now I'm thinking about donuts because I'm very hungry, it's going to destroy you. And remember that temptation is constantly around the corner. It's going to surprise you. It's going to be there. So that's why we lean on the Holy Spirit. It's important to understand that the Holy Spirit is not just this weird, like, Casper the Ghost kind of thing that we don't understand. Okay? The Holy Spirit, if you're a follower of Christ, lives in you. That's what goes into your heart when you give your life to Christ. It's the Holy Spirit that goes in you. And the Holy Spirit, think of it like electricity. Like if I want to heat up a leftover dinner and I don't plug in the microwave, it's just going to be a silly thing that the food is just going to sit there and do nothing. It's not going to heat up. You have to plug in the appliance in order for it to work. And so for you to need to have the Holy Spirit and for it to work for you to defeat temptation, you got to lean into it. You got to plug into it. And I want you to think about things like reading your Bible and prayer and journaling and fasting. And I'm not talking about just food because that's super hard. But fasting in terms of like turning off your cell phones for 24 hours. That's a really hard thing to think about for our culture, to turn off our cell phones. Turn off your cell phones. Turn off the TV. Don't watch any movies. Like, just relax and be present in the moment. Those kind of things you can fast from, too, to take away. It's something that takes something that distracts you so that you can be focused. So the whole thing, when you plug those things, Bible reading, prayer, fasting, journaling, it's a plugging into the electricity. It's plugging your heart into the heart of God so that you can be filled and you can be replenished. Don't think of those tasks like a to-do list. Because if we think of it like a to-do list, man, every time we read it, it's going to be like, oh, gosh. Man, I got my Bible reading plan has me reading 5 chapters today. Man, that's a lot of reading. I don't know if I have the attention span for that. Don't think of it like a to-do list. Think of it like plugging in. God, I need this to replenish my soul, replenish my heart, so that I will be able to be strong to defeat temptation. Because temptation, again, it's around the corner. It's waiting. It's coming. And so here are some ways that we can easily fall into temptation. First of all, we might be really distracted by the things of the world. So we're more focused on our career. We're more focused on our kids, more focused on how our sports teams are doing. We're more focused on anything, our finances, our cars, anything that you can think of. We're more focused on that. We put our attention more on that. And then when temptation comes, it's easy to fall into. Or we might be into kind of, we might have some habits that are really bad that lead us into a habitual sin that we can't seem to break, and we don't look for help. And let me tell you, if you're in that kind of a sin, it's actually impossible. I think it's impossible to break without getting help. You need help. And that doesn't even have to mean, like, I'm not talking professional where you pay somebody. A brother or sister in Christ that you know and love and cares for you, that can stand beside you and walk with you. Even that is a great way to get some help. And then again, we might trust in more of our own strength, that we plug into our own strength, use our own electricity, and that doesn't work. That's not going to work. That's going to deplete us. We'll run out of energy. It's not going to sustain us. And so that's our third attitude. We're going to look now at the rest of the section 39 through 42. Let's read that together. Once more, he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." So Jesus goes and comes back. So he prays, comes back 3 times. This mirrors the failure of Peter. Peter's going to deny 3 times. 3 times Jesus came back and said the same thing in the prayer. And so Jesus keeps praying. He keeps pursuing it. He is persistent. And that's another thing in prayer. You can be persistent with God. Continue to ask him to do things. But they kept sleeping because they were not aware. They were not keeping watch. And Jesus had been telling them frequently, even, you know, throughout his whole time with them, even the last couple hours, "You're going to be tempted to deny me. I have to go to death. This is something I'm going to have to do." And so here's a few ways that they were not able to keep watch, why they weren't able to keep watch the way that they were, and why we, at the same time, have trouble keeping watch and keeping vigilant as Christians for what, for temptation around the corner, or for what God would have us do in our lives. First of all, is we misunderstand who Jesus came to be. We might think of Jesus like a cosmic genie who all he has to do is just pray and ask for a bunch of wishes, and it's his job to grant them. That's not who God is. That's not what Jesus came to be. First and foremost, Jesus came to die on the cross for our sins and then raise from the dead so that we could have new life. That's the point of Christianity. That's it. Everything else is kind of an offshoot to it. So we misunderstand. We make out God to be in our own image rather than letting him be who he is. And then sometimes we don't even take the claims of Jesus seriously enough. You know, that claim I said earlier about denying yourself, taking up your cross and following me, we might make excuses and say, "Well, no, God, maybe you were talking about those people, not me." No, he talks about that with all of us. That's the only way. Deny yourself completely and follow him. Take up your cross and follow him. Or we don't heed the call of Jesus wholeheartedly, where he says, "Come and be my disciples and go and make disciples." The whole point of Christianity, truly, is that each and every person becomes a disciple and then as a result makes disciples. So our job, my job, your job, it's not left to quote unquote professionals. Every person that becomes a follower of Christ is called to make a disciple, to make disciples, to make other people who will follow Christ. So sometimes we don't follow that wholeheartedly and we are more focused on a litany of things that are all across the gambit, all across the spectrum, instead of focusing in on what God has called us to do. And then as well, we don't commit ourselves to these spiritual disciplines, the things I was talking about, like prayer and Bible reading and even community groups, things like that. That's a good spiritual discipline, to be in community, living with people, talking to them about how your walk with Jesus is going. To be a part of church on Sunday mornings, I would call it spiritual discipline, so that you can get replenished and refilled. We got to do those things. Got it. And it's so important because it fills us up. It gives us what we need. And again, I want you to think of it like food, not obligations, not like a list of duties, but as like a food that you desperately need to keep you replenished and healthy and moving forward. And so when Jesus comes again, finally at this point, Judas shows up. And look at what he says. He says, enough. And it's not the enough where, you know, parents, you've been there, where your kids have driven you to the point of madness and you just explode and say, enough. That's not what Jesus is talking about here. That's not what he's doing. Notice what he does. He says, the hour has come. So he says, this scenario, it's done. The hour has come. God has basically answered his prayer. And you know what the answer was? No. Jesus' prayer, again, to remind ourselves, is that Jesus was asking for God to find another way. If it's God, all things are possible for you. You can do this. Find another way. And God says no. Because God is saying, this is the way. This is the plan. This is what you need to do. You've got to do it. You've got to follow through. And notice how Jesus reacts. He says, look, here they are. And so his focus is now fully on that, saying, I'm going. So this is our fourth attitude. And I think this is one of the hardest ones to do, is to trust God no matter what his answer. For me, there's been many times in my life where I've asked God for things and he has said no. And we have to learn that prayer to say, okay, God, you're saying no. Because of your love that was shown on the cross, I have to believe that you are a good and loving God and you know what's best for me, so I need to trust you, even though I don't want to, even though I don't like it. And God is comfortable with that. God wants you to get your heart changed to the point where you do automatically trust him no matter what. But man, that is a hard thing to learn. And sometimes, you know what, God is going to say no. And that's okay. The point again is to trust him, to believe in him, and to submit ourselves to him to the point, because of how good he is, because of his love for us, because he knows what he's doing. And Jesus is the ultimate example for us. Because even though Jesus asked for this very significant thing, Jesus still acted out in submission and willing obedience to God to go to the cross on our behalf. If Jesus doesn't do that, we don't have salvation. God is basically telling him, there is no other way. This is the way. This is what needs to happen. And so let's ask this question. We're getting ready to close here. How much are you willing to submit yourself like Jesus did to the Father? What areas in your life do you need to start surrendering yourself to God and to say to him, God, your will be done, not mine? And sometimes those are going to be hard areas. I was talking to somebody after the service and it really touched on my heart because it's hard for me. She was talking about her kid, about what God would do with her kid in the future. And nothing's wrong with the kid. Just happy, smiley kid. But what is God going to do? Can I trust him with my child? That's hard. I'm with that. I'm only 9.5 months into this parenting thing. And that's a hard question. Am I willing to say to God, God, this is your child, not mine. You're in control of her life, not me. All my job is to try and show her who Jesus is and try and disciple her so she will be a follower of Christ later on in life. So how much are you willing to submit yourself and to say to Jesus, your will be done, not mine? And then truly a great way for us to learn this kind of submission and surrender to God is a consistent and vibrant prayer life. And if prayer for you is so mysterious that you don't understand it, we have a lot of people here at this church that can teach you how to do that. In fact, little plug, if you are a first-time guest with us and you put your communication card in the offering basket later, you can get a free book on prayer by our pastor, Pastor Ron Kincaid, called The Prayer Dare. It's all about prayer. That's a great way for you to learn about what prayer is about. Or you can talk to somebody that knows how to do it. Or if you're a regular here, go buy that book, you know, to learn how to pray. God is patient with us to learn those things. God is not expecting us to be like at the top of our game, you know, to be like the LeBron James of prayer. That seems really strange to say that, but you know, to be at the top level possible of our game of prayer. No, he expects you to develop and grow and get better and take time and practice. It's all a practice. And so that's what's going to help you really grow. You can't grow in your relationship with Jesus unless you have that consistent and vibrant prayer life. And I'll just close with this, to be totally honest. Prayer is something for me that has always been a struggle, because I'm like, no, I got to do this. I got a to-do list. I got all these things to do. I'm way too busy. I've realized I'm too busy not to pray. Because if I don't, my day is not going to go well. I've noticed a huge and significant difference in my day when I start my day. First thing I do, pop out of bed, you know, as soon as I actually wake up, because I don't do that very well. I'm not a morning person. But to get up, open up a Bible, start reading, and then take some time to pray and journal and take some thoughts down. Because then I start to see God working. I start to see what God is up to in my life. And so that is what our attitude is to be, is to look at prayer as a lifestyle, to submit ourselves wholly to the will of God, to lean on the Holy Spirit to defeat temptation, and then lastly, to trust God no matter what his answer for our prayers. Let's pray. God, we thank you. We thank you for your word. Your word is living and active, sharper than a double-edged sword, piercing to the soul and division, to the division of the soul. God, we thank you that your word speaks to us, exposes us, reveals our hearts. God, we pray that we would truly desire to submit ourselves to you, because you are a good and loving Father God. Not that you are a slave driver telling us what to do, cracking the whip on us, but that God, you are lovingly inviting us into a relationship with you, where you are asking us and you are calling us to do big things, to submit ourselves, but God, because it is what you have designed us to do. It's how you have called us to live. So God, may we trust you. May we surrender ourselves to you. And we pray this in your name. Amen.